From Pacifica, this is Democracy Now!
We are a nation of 200 ethnicities, 160 languages. We open our doors to others and say welcome. And the only thing that must change after the events of Friday is that this same door must close on all of those who espouse hate and fear.
New Zealand remains in a state of mourning 4 days after a white supremacist shot dead 50 Muslim worshippers at two mosques in Christchurch. We'll go to New Zealand to look at how the massacre has affected the nation's Muslim community. And then the Trump administration moves to block staff from the International Criminal Court from entering the United States after the ICC refused to drop war crimes probes targeting the U.S. and Israel.
You should not.
If you're responsible for the proposed ICC investigation of U.S. personnel in connection with a situation in Afghanistan, you should not assume that you will still have or will get a visa, or that you will be permitted to enter the United States.
The Transportation Department has launched an investigation into the FAA's approval of the Boeing 737 MAX 8 jet. We'll look at the Trump administration's close ties to Boeing as the company faces international scrutiny following two deadly airplane crashes that killed nearly 250 people. Trump's acting Defense Secretary Patrick Shanahan spent 31 years as a Boeing executive, and Trump's former U.N. Ambassador Nikki Haley has been nominated to the Boeing Board of Directors. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Burials are beginning in New Zealand as the country mourns the loss of 50 Muslim worshippers gunned down by a white supremacist Friday in the deadliest attack in New Zealand's history. The worshippers killed in the Christchurch massacre came from around the world. Most of them were immigrants or refugees who'd come to New Zealand seeking safety. Six Pakistanis, four Jordanians, four Egyptians, and at least three Bangladeshis are among the dead. The Palestinian Authority's foreign ministry said six of the victims were of Palestinian origin. New Zealand Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern has been calling for unity and support for Muslim communities following the horrific attack. On Friday, she was asked about her phone call with President Trump.
I spoke with Donald Trump this morning. He sought to call us directly. He very much wished for his condolences to be passed on to New Zealand. He asked what offer of support the United States could provide. My message was sympathy and love for all Muslim communities.
Prime Minister Ardern has been widely praised for her response to the attacks and the immediate aftermath. The youngest female head of state in the world vowed to reform gun laws, visited with Muslim communities in New Zealand wearing a hijab as a sign of respect. She also recently pledged to never use the terror suspect's name, instead calling on people to say the names of those killed in the attacks. We'll have more on the Muslim community in New Zealand after headlines. The Daily Beast is reporting the House Judiciary Committee will hold a hearing in the coming weeks on the rise of white nationalism, hate crimes and hate speech in the U.S. The Southern Poverty Law Center found membership in white nationalist groups increased by nearly 50% last year. Government agencies, including the FBI and the Department of Homeland Security, have warned white nationalist attacks are on the rise and pose a major domestic threat. Meanwhile, a recent Huffington Post investigation has found seven current members of the U.S. military belong to white nationalist group Identity Europa, which was founded by a former Marine and was involved in organizing the deadly Unite the Right rally in Charlottesville in 2017. The military says it's investigating those service members. In Mozambique, President Filipe Nyusi said Monday the death toll from tropical cyclone Idai could reach over 1,000 people. The devastating cyclone brought winds of 110 miles per hour and massive flooding to Mozambique and neighboring Zimbabwe and Malawi from Thursday to Saturday in what Mozambique's environment minister called the biggest natural disaster the country has ever faced. Aid agencies warned Idai destroyed 90% of the low-lying port city of Beira, which has a population of over 500,000 people. Meanwhile, in other climate news, massive flooding has forced the closing of much of the Ofoot Air Force Base in Nebraska. Flooding submerged as many as 60 structures on the base, which is the headquarters of the U.S. Strategic Command. In January, the Pentagon released a report warning climate change could threaten two-thirds of the nation's military installations. In October, Hurricane Michael severely damaged Tyndall Air Base in Florida. Vice President Pence is visiting Nebraska today. And the New York Times is reporting Saudi Arabia's Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman approved a covert campaign to silence opponents and critics of the Saudi government. The campaign, which started in 2017 and whose acts were carried out by a group known as the Saudi Rapid Intervention Group, included surveillance, forcible repatriation, kidnapping and torture of dissidents. Some of the covert missions were reportedly carried out by the same individuals involved in the murder of Washington Post columnist Jamal Khashoggi in Istanbul last October. A top aide to the Crown Prince, Saad al-Qahtani, is said to have overseen the campaign. The group is also believed to be involved in the jailing and abuse of at least a dozen women activists who campaigned against the kingdom's ban on female drivers. One of those activists attempted suicide. In more news about Saudi Arabia, Turkey said last week that Interpol had issued a red notice for the arrest of 20 suspects in journalist Jamal Khashoggi's killing, including Saad al-Qahtani. A United Nations commission presented its full report on Israeli crimes in Gaza to the Human Rights Council Monday. The panel called on Israel to stop using live ammunition against unarmed protesters and investigate the shooting of thousands of Palestinians. This is Santiago Canton, chair of the UN War Crimes Commission, speaking in Geneva.
We believe that in situations of crowd control and in situations that we deem to be civilian in nature, if there are individuals in the crowds that may be legitimate target, you still cannot shoot at the crowd because that you may shoot or kill innocent individual.
A summary of the report released last month found Israeli forces may have committed war crimes and crimes against humanity by targeting protesters in Gaza with lethal force, including children, journalists and the disabled. The report looked at Israel's bloody response to weekly Great March of Return demonstrations launched by Palestinians in Gaza nearly a year ago, targeting Israel's heavily militarized fence. It found Israeli forces killed 189 Palestinians, almost all of them with live ammunition. In Britain, the Speaker of the House of Commons dealt a new blow Monday to Prime Minister Theresa May by barring another vote in Parliament on her Brexit agreement, just 11 days before the UK is set to leave the European Union.
What the government cannot legitimately do is to resubmit to the House the same proposition or substantially the same proposition as that of last week, which was rejected by 149 votes.
That was Speaker John Bercow. Britain may now request a Brexit extension from European leaders. France has announced tough new measures on yellow vest protests as the anti-government demonstrations entered their fourth month over the weekend, marked by clashes with the police, nearly 200 arrests and damage to businesses by some protesters. Police used tear gas and water cannons on crowds in Paris. On Monday, Prime Minister Edouard Philippe banned the yellow vest from the Champs-Élysées and certain neighborhoods, as well as announced the shutdown of any protests that included violent or, quote, ultra-radicalized groups. The prime minister also said the Paris police chief would be replaced and police officers would be granted more autonomy. In the Netherlands, authorities have arrested a man suspected of shooting passengers on a tram in the city of Utrecht, killing three people and injuring five others. 37-year-old Gökmen Tanis, who is originally from Turkey, reportedly has a criminal record, including a possible rape charge. One of the victims of the shooting may be the gunman's ex-wife, according to some reports. Dutch authorities initially believed the attack may have a terrorist motive, but later said it was no longer being treated as such. Another Mexican journalist and radio host has been killed at his home in Sonora, which lies on the U.S.-Mexico border, neighboring Arizona. Unidentified gunmen shot and killed Santiago Barroso on Friday, making him the fourth known reporter to be killed in Mexico this year. Shortly before his murder, Barroso reported on smugglers attempting to bring a group of migrants across the border. Human rights and press freedom groups are calling on the Mexican government to investigate the killing and put in place measures to better protect journalists. British nonprofit Article 19 finds there is a 99% impunity rate for crimes against journalists in Mexico. Representatives of Venezuelan opposition leader Juan Guaido took control of multiple diplomatic properties in the U.S. Monday with the support of the U.S. State Department, including the consulate in New York and two diplomatic buildings in Washington, D.C. The government of sitting President Nicolas Maduro, which cut diplomatic ties with the U.S. over its support for his ouster, called on U.S. officials to, quote, reverse this forcible occupation. In Nicaragua, police arrested over 100 people over the weekend after protesters took to the streets demanding the government of President Daniel Ortega release all political prisoners and following Friday's release of 50 prisoners amidst an ongoing crackdown on journalists and government critics. Last month, Ortega vowed to reopen talks with political opponents. This is a protester speaking in Managua Saturday.
We are calling for freedom for all our political prisoners. The government has accepted that there are political prisoners. The only crime that they committed was to raise their flag and their voices for Nicaragua.
The House Judiciary Committee said it received tens of thousands of documents from some of the 81 individuals and groups contacted as part of the committee's sweeping probe into President Trump and his businesses over possible obstruction of justice, corruption, and other crimes and abuses of power. The committee did not reveal specifically who handed over records, but Judiciary Chair Gerald Nadler told MSNBC Monday that former Trump campaign adviser Stephen Bannon was one of the people who handed over a few thousand documents. Meanwhile, the Daily Beast is reporting Trump's legal team told Congressmember Nadler they would not be handing over any requested documents. The House panel has said they would likely issue subpoenas to anyone who refused to comply with their request. A new report by Reveal from the Center for Investigative Reporting found the U.S. government operates secret shelters to detain some unaccompanied migrant minors. The facilities, which are outside of the regular Office of Refugee Resettlement Network, reportedly specialize in housing youth with mental or behavioral challenges. The practice may be in violation of a long-standing agreement that says the government must provide lawyers with accurate information on the whereabouts of all children in its care. It's unknown how many such sites exist, but Reveal identified at least five locations where at least 16 immigrant children are detained, some as young as 9 years old. At least one of the facilities has previously been accused of numerous violations, including sexual and physical abuse. At a town hall Monday night, Senator and 2020 hopeful Elizabeth Warren called for voting reforms, including doing away with the Electoral College.
Every vote matters. And the way we can make that happen is that we can have national voting, and that means get rid of the Electoral College.
Senator Warren was responding to a question from Rukia Lumumba, activist and former campaign manager for Chokwe Lumumba, her brother, the former mayor of Jackson, Mississippi. In Dallas, Texas, former President George W. Bush and First Lady Laura Bush attended a naturalization ceremony in Dallas in a rare public appearance. Bush said, quote, amidst all the complications of policy, may we never forget that immigration is a blessing and a strength. Bush's comments came as President Trump signed his first veto Friday, overturning Congress's vote on blocking his national emergency to build a wall on the U.S.-Mexico border. Iowa Congressmember and supporter of white nationalist Steve King posted an image to Facebook over the weekend showing two figures formed by red and blue states in a fight with the words, one side has about 8 trillion bullets, while the other side doesn't know which bathroom to use. Steve King added the caption, wonder who would win. The bathroom reference is an apparent mocking of transgender rights. The image was later removed from King's page. The congressmember was stripped of his House committee assignments earlier this year over his support for white supremacy. And two U.S. veterans for peace are being held in Ireland after protesting U.S. warplanes refueling there. Military planes regularly refuel at Shannon Airport before continuing on to U.S. wars in the Middle East. Veterans for Peace Ken Mayers and Tara Kauf, currently in Limerick prison, could be held up for up to 2 years pre-trial after entering the airfield carrying a large banner that said, U.S. veterans say respect Irish neutrality, U.S. war machine out of Shannon Airport, Veterans for Peace. Ed Horgan, coordinator of Irish Veterans for Peace, said this process is a clear attempt to punish the two Veterans for Peace activists before any trial takes place. We're calling on all peace and human rights activists in Ireland and internationally to campaign not only on behalf of Ken Mayers and Tara Kauf, but more important, on behalf of all the innocent people being killed and injured by U.S. illegal wars, unquote. And a correction, the mayor of Jackson, Mississippi, is Chokwe Lumumba. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman.
And I'm Juan Gonzalez. Welcome to all of our listeners and viewers across the country and around the world. Burials are beginning in New Zealand as the country mourns the loss of 50 Muslim worshippers gunned down in two mosques in Christchurch by a white supremacist Friday. It was the deadliest attack in New Zealand's history. The worshippers killed in the Christchurch massacre came from around the world. Most of them were immigrants or refugees who had come to New Zealand seeking safety. Six Pakistanis, four Jordanians, four Egyptians, and at least three Bangladeshis are among the dead. The Palestinian Authority's foreign ministry said that six of the victims were of Palestinian origin. 16-year-old Syrian refugee Hamza Mustafa was killed in the attack alongside his brother Khalid, who had come to New Zealand to escape atrocities in Syria. 71-year-old Haji Dawood Nabi, who fled war in Afghanistan and settled in New Zealand 40 years ago, was killed while shielding a friend's body at the Al Noor Mosque. The family of the youngest victim, 3-year-old Muad Ibrahim, came from Somalia as refugees fleeing violence decades before last week's attack.
50-year-old Naeem Rashid was killed at the Al Noor Mosque after he tried to grab the shooter's gun. Rashid was a teacher from Pakistan who'd been planning his son's spring wedding. His son, Thala, was killed alongside his father. Pakistan's prime minister announced Rashid would be presented with a national award for his bravery. New Zealand football goalkeeper, 33-year-old Atta Lyon, who had just become a father, was also among the 50 victims. So were 14-year-old Syed Milne, 44-year-old Husna Ahmed, and father of two, Lilik Abdul Hamid. This is New Zealand Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern speaking Tuesday.
We are a nation of 200 ethnicities, 160 languages. We open our doors to others and say welcome. And the only thing that must change after the events of Friday is that this same door must close on all of those who espouse hate and fear. We wish for every member of our communities to also feel safe. Safety means being free from the fear of violence. But it also means being free from the fear of those sentiments of racism and hate that create a place where violence can flourish. And every single one of us has the power to change that.
Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern has been widely praised for her response to the attacks. She wore hijab while visiting with Muslim communities as a sign of respect. Ardern, who is the youngest female head of state, also vowed to reform gun laws and pledged to never use the terror suspect's name. Instead, she is calling on people to speak the names of those killed in the attacks. More people died in Friday's mass shooting than are typically murdered in an entire year in New Zealand, which is the world's second safest country, according to the 2018 Global Peace Index.
For more, we're joined by Eva Nisa, a lecturer in religious studies at Victoria University of Wellington, New Zealand. Her recent article for Middle East Eye is headlined, New Zealand has been a home to Muslims for centuries and will remain so. Eva Nisa, first, our condolences for this terrible massacre, this atrocity committed against the Muslim community, against the whole community of New Zealand. Can you talk about the origins of the Muslim community in your country?
Okay, first of all, thank you very much for the deepest sympathy. New Zealand migrants, Muslims in New Zealand, basically have been living here since the 18th century, 1769. New Zealanders already could see there was these two Muslims came with the French vessel. But at that time, of course, Islam was not really like we couldn't see the clear face of Islam because only two people, and they didn't settle too. Only in the 1850s, then we could see one family from India came to New Zealand, and since then we could see that the number of Muslims is also growing.
And could you talk about what countries most of the Muslims who have migrated to New Zealand come from?
Basically, Muslims in New Zealand, their backgrounds, it's ethnically diverse. But according to the very late census, 1991 census, when there was a census regarding the ethnic backgrounds of Muslims, it mentioned that 49% of Muslims, they come from South Asian backgrounds, especially the Indian ethnic backgrounds, and mostly up to this time, most Muslims in New Zealand, we can say that they have Asian backgrounds. And then after that, followed by Muslims from other countries, of course, other ethnicities.
I want to turn to the New Zealand Prime Minister, Jacinda Ardern, speaking shortly after the attack about her phone call with President Trump.
I spoke with Donald Trump this morning. He sought to call us directly. He very much wished for his condolences to be passed on to New Zealand. He asked what offer of support the United States could provide. My message was sympathy and love for all Muslim communities.
Ivanisa, your response.
Yeah, I think that's one of the thing that one of the things that have been mentioned a lot by New Zealanders. If Muslims are asked, what do you need? Even if Muslims are asked, what do you need? They will also say the same. We just need the love and support and also a sympathy. Because the other thing is, I think New Zealanders, we are very shocked with this kind of thing because this never happened before. I mean, Jacinda Ardern mentioned this is unprecedented tragedy too. So we don't need let's say a political kind of comments or some. I mean, I know that some politicians they have mentioned some comments, and then they've used this. Some of them even use this tragedy as part of their political tools to show that look, there is this clash between Islam and Christianity or Islam and the West. So that kind of, we don't need that kind of. So we need just love, support, and sympathy.
I also wanted to ask you about the response of New Zealand Prime Minister Jacinta Ardern and how she's being praised, wearing a hijab, comforting the victims' families, and also, as you just said, talking about Muslims as us. This is the Prime Minister speaking on Friday.
Many of those who will have been directly affected by this shooting may be migrants to New Zealand. They may even be refugees here. They have chosen to make New Zealand their home, and it is their home. They are us. The person who has perpetuated this violence against us is not.
They have no place in New Zealand.
And, of course, the prime minister's comments are being contrasted with President Trump. She made those comments on Friday. It wasn't hours later that President Trump signed the veto on Congress trying to stop his wall on the border, where he used the same terms that were used in the assailant's manifesto, the assassin's manifesto, referring to immigrants as invaders, immigrants coming over the border as an invasion. Eva Nisa, can you talk about the response of your prime minister, the youngest woman leader in the world?
Yeah, I think Jacinda's, I mean, most New Zealanders, we are very happy with the comments made by our Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern. The hashtag unity is power, and New Zealand is home to for the migrants. It's always has been repeated a lot, and New Zealand has been very committed to open its gate for migrants, especially, I mean, lately in 2015. The government committed that we would receive 750 Syrian refugees, and then after that, the government added the number of the quota to 1,000 Syrian refugees. So that's one of the things that needs to be underlined, that New Zealand is basically we are committed to welcome refugees and to make them feel that New Zealand is their home. That's right. That kind of stuff is it's very important. And the other thing regarding Jacinda Ardern with the veil, that's also one of the things mentioned a lot, that many Muslims feel like this kind of support. I mean, small gesture like this means a lot. And one of the things that is quite heartbreaking on a Sunday, there were these two young Muslims were verbally abused or attacked by this man. And yeah, he said that you just go to your own country. So, but the good thing is this man was drunk. So it's one of the thing that, because you know, when this kind of thing happened, there's this what we know as gendered Islamophobia. So women, Muslim women, especially those who wear veil, they are visibly more recognizable as Muslims. So showing her support by wearing a veil, it means a lot for many Muslims here in New Zealand.
And even this, I wanted to ask you, New Zealand has a relatively small Muslim population, about, I think, 1% of the country, compared to Australia, that has a much larger percentage, or even, obviously, all of Western Europe. Have you seen a rise in white supremacist expressions or public statements in New Zealand over the past few years?
Yeah, many analysts and also scholars have mentioned that there is an increase in this kind of hate speech, especially comes from white supremacists, and especially for the last 2 decades, some scholars mentioned that one. Some Muslims, they've mentioned too that there's, especially post 9/11. That happens in many countries. I mean, I know that in the United States this also happened. There's an increase in hate speech. So we are facing that one too. But it's very difficult to confirm, because of course we don't have record. There's no up to this time we don't have hate law in here in New Zealand.
I wanted to quote Anjum Rahman, a spokeswoman with the Islamic Women's Council of New Zealand, who wrote in an op-ed that the council's growing fears about Islamophobia and the rise of the right in New Zealand were ignored by the government for years. She writes, quote, "We talked about the effects of discrimination, the issues in our communities, the rise of the alt-right, and the increasing level of vitriol we were seeing online and in person. We begged and pleaded. We demanded. We knocked on every door we could. We spoke at every forum we were invited to. My community wants and needs accountability," she said. And I wanted to end with Waleed Ali, the Muslim host of an Australian news program, The Project. Here he is speaking Friday, just hours after the massacres. The video has received millions of views.
"You'll have to forgive me. These won't be my best words. The truth is, I don't want to be talking today. When I was asked if it's something that I wanted to do, I resisted it all day until finally I had this overwhelming sense that it was somehow my responsibility to do so. I went to the mosque today. I do that every Friday, just like the people in those mosques in Christchurch today. I know exactly what those moments before the shooting began would have been like. I know how quiet, how still, how introspective those people would have been before they were suddenly gunned down. If you've been talking about being tough on terrorism for years in the communities that allegedly support it, then show us how tough you are now. For mine, I'm going to say the same thing I said about 4 years ago after a horrific Islamist attack. Now, now we come together. Now we understand this is not a game. Terrorism doesn't choose its victims selectively. That we are one community, and that everything we say to try to tear people apart, demonize particular groups, set them against each other, that all has consequences, even if we're not the ones with our fingers on the trigger."
Waleed Ali, the Muslim host of the Australian news program, The Project. And we want to thank Eva Nisa, the lecturer in religious studies at Victoria University of Wellington, New Zealand. We'll link to her piece in Middle East Eye, headline, "New Zealand has been a home to Muslims for centuries and will remain so." This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. When we come back, the U.S. blocking members of the International Criminal Court. Stay with us. Violin Concerto No. 1 in G minor in Adagio by Max Bruch. This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez.
We turn now to the Trump administration's decision to bar International Criminal Court investigators from entering the U.S. In September, National Security Advisor John Bolton threatened U.S. sanctions against ICC judges if they continue to investigate alleged war crimes committed by U.S. troops in Afghanistan. A 2016 report by the International Criminal Court accused the U.S. military of torturing at least 61 prisoners in Afghanistan during the ongoing war. The report also accused the CIA of subjecting at least 27 prisoners to torture, including rape, at CIA prison sites in Afghanistan, Poland, Romania, and Lithuania. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo announced Friday that the U.S. will start denying visas to members of the ICC who may be investigating alleged war crimes by the U.S. military in Afghanistan.
"Since 1998, the United States has declined to join the ICC because of its broad, unaccountable prosecutorial powers and the threat it poses to American national sovereignty. we are determined to protect the American and allied military and civilian personnel from living in fear of unjust prosecution for actions taken to defend our great nation. We feared that the court could eventually pursue politically motivated prosecutions of Americans, and our fears were warranted. In November of 2017, the ICC prosecutor requested approval to initiate an investigation into, quote, the situation in Afghanistan, end of quote, that could illegitimately target American personnel for prosecutions and sentencing. In September of 2018, the Trump administration warned the ICC that if it tried to pursue an investigation of Americans, there would be consequences. I understand that the prosecutor's request for an investigation remains pending. Thus, today, persistent to existing legal authority to impose visa restrictions on any alien, quote, whose entry or proposed activities in the United States would have potentially serious adverse foreign policy consequences, end of quote, I'm announcing a policy of U.S. visa restrictions on those individuals directly responsible for any ICC investigation of U.S. personnel. This includes persons who take or have taken action to request or further such an investigation. These visa restrictions may also be used to deter ICC efforts to pursue allied personnel, including Israelis, without allies' consent.
Secretary of State Mike Pompeo to talk more about the U.S. decision to deny visas to those involved in the International Criminal Court investigation. We're joined now by Jamil Dakwar, the director of the Human Rights Program at the American Civil Liberties Union. Welcome back to Democracy Now! It's great to have you with us. Your response to this announcement?
Look, I think this is unprecedented. This is the first time that the U.S. government is targeting foreign judges and prosecutors, personnel of international, one of the most respected international judicial bodies in the world, with the travel ban. As far as we look back, there hasn't been any kind of precedent for such a thing. They're not only doing that, they're also saying anyone who assisted the ICC worked or will work to push for accountability for investigation before the ICC with regard to the situation in Afghanistan, particularly looking at U.S. involvement in war crimes, will be subject to the same visa restrictions. So this is an act of a country that, similar to authoritarian regime, when you're crushing dissent, when you're going after those who are disagreeing with you, when you are trying to punish and retaliate and intimidate those who are trying to hold you accountable, you use their powers in order to limit the way that they can do that. And that's really very outrageous and very concerning to us that this is reaching to this level. But it also speaks to what this administration has been doing. I mean, this administration threatened with prosecuting judges and the prosecutors of the ICC for doing their job and for doing the job that the United States should have done, that is to investigate credibly and thoroughly war crimes and crimes against humanity that were committed in the course of the war in Afghanistan, including the use of black sites, not only in Afghanistan. This is another important aspect of this investigation or impending investigation, because it hasn't been really fully authorized by the pretrial chamber, is that it would cover not just what happened in Afghanistan, but it would cover in three countries that are linked to the conflict in Afghanistan. That is Poland, Romania, and Lithuania, because they are state parties. They joined the ICC since 2002, when the court was started to function. So we will see how this will play out. We're very happy that the responses so far in just the last few days from members of the court, particularly European countries, have been very strong in condemning the Trump administration and upholding the independence and legitimacy of the court, and that any actions to deter prosecutors and the judges, that would be not acceptable and will be rejected by U.S. allies, particularly in Europe.
Well, let me ask you, this is reflective of an overall tendency in the Trump administration. Last year, the U.S. withdrew from the United Nations Human Rights Council as well, and it's resisted over 20 requests by special rapporteurs of the United Nations looking into particular issues of human rights violations here. But this is a step further. This is not just refusing to cooperate. This is actually punishing people who are trying to get to the facts of what's happened. In terms of what can be done in response by the international community to what, in essence, is the United States saying no one has a right to judge what we do abroad?
Well, first of all, let's start with what the Secretary Pompeo said. They said it's an attack on our sovereignty. I don't think that anyone attacked U.S. sovereignty. It was this Afghanistan sovereignty that has been subject to the jurisdiction, because Afghanistan joined the ICC in May of 2003 and agreed that if there will be war crimes, crimes against humanity or genocide, these are the worst crimes that are defined under the ICC statute or their treaty, that they would be jurisdiction for the court. So it's not an issue of U.S. sovereignty. It's not also an issue of protecting the constitutional right of American citizens who could be tried abroad. That's not something that we see again and again. If you committed a crime abroad, you could be committing it anywhere in the world. You could be held accountable by those countries where you violated their criminal laws. And therefore, there is no such a thing of attacking or undermining American sovereignty. The second thing is that Secretary Pompeo is saying there was no consent of the governments their nationals being prosecuted or investigated by the ICC in the future. Since when war criminals have to get their consent to a criminal investigation? That's unheard of. So the nature of the attacks, as you said, they are punitive, they're retaliatory. They are trying to go and to send a message, not just to the ICC personnel in this particular. This actually has consequences beyond the United States situation of U.S. Government officials who commissioned, ordered, or implemented acts of torture in Afghanistan and elsewhere. So it is really a serious threat to the system that we created. The United States was responsible for creating systems after World War II, after the horror of the Holocaust, that would fight impunity, that would combat the worst crimes. And now the U.S. is leading the charge in attacking the judges. And being cheered by what countries? Cheered by Sudan, Burundi, the Philippines.
Philippines, which also just pulled out of the International Criminal Court in the last few days. Could I ask you also, though, this must indicate that there is a real fear here on the part of the U.S. government about this investigation to take this kind of drastic action. Could you talk about what some of what the preliminary findings of the court are in terms of the war crimes committed here?
So first, it's important to highlight that the court, the ICC, is a court of last resort, meaning it doesn't jump in to investigate a crime just because it violates the crimes defined by the Rome Statute, by the ICC. It actually waits and sees what the countries that join the court are doing. What have they done in order to investigate violations of the ICC? And that is an important point, because the ICC, people think that the ICC, immediately acted, automatically opened investigations. That's not true. In the case of the United States, the situation in Afghanistan lasted for over a decade, where it was under so-called preliminary examination. So it was based on publicly available information. The ICC prosecutor would not use its investigative powers, but rely on media reports, on UN reports, other NGOs reports, etc. And yes, once it comes to the conclusion that there is a reasonable belief that there would crimes that are committed in violation of the ICC, and it has a jurisdiction, and it has to also satisfy other requirements, admissibility and the interests of justice, it would then, because this one was initiated by the prosecutor's office, it would have to get an authorization from the pretrial chamber, a chamber of three judges of the ICC that then examine the whole evidence. The evidence that she has is really relying heavily. We don't have access to that information, but we believe that her evidence is based on the Senate torture report, the well-documented investigation of the CIA involvement in the most brutal and gruesome acts of humiliation and torture against prisoners. And that torture report was released in December of 2014, basically made put the United States on notice that if the United States is not acting in light of the declassified parts of the report, because the report itself, the whole thing, was still classified. So we don't even have a clue what's in the details of that report, because the U.S. government, both under the Obama administration and under the Trump administration, resisting declassification. But what is publicly available, and there is enough to justify opening an investigation. So the prosecutor looked into that information. It looked at what the United States has done in order to hold officials accountable, both at the level of the U.S. military and the level of the CIA officials, a level of all chain of command, meaning looking not just at the lower rank officers and military personnel, but also at the leaders who sanctioned this policy. You have the highest level of the White House and the Bush administration that ordered the torture program. So they looked at what the Bush administration, the Obama administration have done in order to investigate, and they reached the conclusion that they were not credible investigations, and that's why they're stepping in. And they're stepping in because this is an important for the rule of law, it's important for upholding international principles against impunity, and it's also providing victims of torture their day in court. And that is where I think more than anything is important and being sidelined by the whole response to Pompeo.
Can you talk about how psychologists James Mitchell and Bruce Jessen could be implicated in the investigation, who reaped tens of millions of dollars for designing torture techniques for the CIA?
So these two individuals were psychologists in their private practice, were hired by the CIA after the terrorist attacks in 9/11 in order to help design and implement a torture program. They have come up with, really based on pseudoscience, it was really junk science, a theory of how to break down detainees. And how to break down those suspected in involvement in the 9/11 attacks. There has been clear evidence that we have exposed in our lawsuit, the ACLU lawsuit, against the two individuals that was settled a couple of years ago that showed that the information that they relied on, the science that there was really out of in line with any scientific, and that is. Purpose was really to coerce and to lead detainees to say things that may have not done. And in fact, I think the Senate torture report has confirmed that the whole program, not only was costly, was not effective, but it was also was misleading in the way that it presented as if those two individuals. So these two individuals made over $80 million off this program, and they, as individuals who acted on behalf of the U.S. government, may also be subject to the ICC investigation if it's authorized. We don't know who are the individuals who will be authorized, but I think that they should be worried. Other people who were involved particularly in the worst part of the CIA torture program should be worried, I think, in the future. That doesn't mean that the ICC will again rush into prioritizing the investigation and prosecuting of U.S. officials. I think that there are other crimes that are being investigated in the Afghanistan situation, especially the crimes against Afghan nationals and the civilian population by the Taliban, by the Afghan forces there. Now, the real serious challenge for the ICC is none of those parties, Afghan government, the Taliban, and the U.S. government, is willing to cooperate with the ICC. So the real challenge is how, if this investigation moves forward, how the ICC will really be able to build cases based on lack, without any cooperation of these countries.
And very quickly, Pompeo also named Israel, if the ICC says it's going to investigate Israel.
Yes, so the Secretary's announcement didn't only say that it's about U.S. Officials that will be targeted by potential investigation of the ICC. He also alluded to U.S. allies and particularly Israeli officials. There is a separate investigation. It's called the Palestine situation. That was actually not the initiation of the prosecutor. It was a referral by the Palestine to investigate war crimes and crimes against humanity in the context of the Gaza situation, the war in 2014. Ukraine, also the recent attacks on protesters in the Gaza border, as well as the legality of settlements in the West Bank, to what extent they violate the ICC statute. So there's also that situation where they could impact, in our view, human rights defenders, human rights lawyers, who are acting to hold officials, in this case, Israeli officials, accountable before the ICC. They could be subject to visa restrictions. And so this is really a serious issue that have to be addressed by the U.S. Congress, particularly the House Foreign Relations Committee. We filed a Freedom of Information Act to ask for the legal basis for this policy. The U.S. government is resisting, and we're likely to file a lawsuit soon to force this information to be disclosed, because it's not really about going after every U.S. citizen who served in the U.S. military. That is not what we're talking about here. This is here talking about really shutting down a legitimate investigation into war crimes. It is about deflecting from scrutiny, deflecting from upholding international law, and giving not only U.S. officials the immunity and punity that they have enjoyed for years, but also giving other countries the same. And that's what emboldening other regimes that we've seen over the past several months been happy to withdraw from the ICC, like the Philippines did just a year ago, and it came into effect a couple of days ago.
And Jamil Dakwa, we want to thank you for being with us, Director of the Human Rights Program at the American Civil Liberties Union. When we come back, we look at the close relationship between the Trump administration and Boeing in 30 seconds. The legendary Lebanese-American musician Dick Dale, who is known as the King of the Surf Guitar, has died at the age of 81. His hit song, Miserlou, was an adaptation of a traditional Arabic folk tune. Dale continued performing live into this year, in part to pay his medical bills from bouts with cancer, renal failure and diabetes. He once said, "I have to perform to save my life." This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez.
Well, the Trump administration's close ties to Boeing are facing new scrutiny in the wake of deadly plane crashes in Indonesia and Ethiopia involving the Boeing 737 MAX 8 jet. The Transportation Department has launched an investigation into the Federal Aviation Administration's approval of the plane since Ethiopian Airlines Flight 302 crashed last week, killing all 157 people on board. The Ethiopian Transport Minister said early investigations have revealed clear similarities between the crash in Ethiopia and the Indonesian Lion Air Flight 610 that crashed in October, killing 189 people. While the detailed information has yet to be released, flight tracking data shows both flights seem to go through unpredictable climbs and descents before crashing just minutes after takeoff. The U.S. did not immediately ground Boeing 737 MAX 8 jets after the crash in Ethiopia, despite growing international pressure. President Trump eventually ordered U.S. airlines to ground all the planes, but continued to praise Boeing. All Boeing 737 MAX jets around the world have now been grounded.
President Trump has publicly praised Boeing hundreds of times in his 2 years in office and participated in efforts to sell its planes, including the 737 MAX series, to countries and airlines around the world. Boeing CEO Dennis Muilenburg praised Trump's support at a dinner last August at Trump's Bedminster, New Jersey golf club. Acting Defense Secretary Patrick Shanahan, who was appointed by Trump, spent 31 years as a Boeing executive. And Trump's former U.N. ambassador Nikki Haley has been nominated to the Boeing Board of Directors. We go now to Washington, D.C., where we're joined by Bill Hartung, director of the Arms and Security Project at the Center for International Policy. In January, he wrote the piece for The Nation headlined, "A Former Boeing Executive is Now Running the Pentagon." Do you think that has some bearing, Bill Hartung, on the—on President Trump dragging his feet on the grounding of the MAX series after almost 250 people were killed between Indonesia and Ethiopia in the Boeing MAX 8 planes?
Well, it's hard to know how Donald Trump's mind works, obviously. But Boeing has such clout in Washington, particularly on the defense side, but also viewed as a major commercial force in its airline business, that it's certainly possible. You know, we don't have a smoking gun, so to speak. But, you know, as you said, Trump is so close to Boeing. I wouldn't rule it out that at least it gave them pause about doing anything that would hurt Boeing's interests.
And Bill Hartson, what about the whole issue of the FAA's role in green lighting the use of the 737 MAX 8 and basically depending on Boeing to be the one to let them know that everything was okay with the new plane?
Well, this is a common practice. You know, you sort of like companies sort of capture the regulatory agencies, and the regulatory agencies almost become partners or supporters of industry instead of regulators of industry. So I think that's part of what happened here.
Bill Hartung, can you talk about Shanahan, the longest acting defense secretary in history, his significance and his, you know, long history at Boeing, and what that means for U.S. foreign policy and the Pentagon?
Well, this is what Eisenhower had in mind when he talked about unwarranted influence by the military-industrial complex. There couldn't be a better example of this. And in his 31 years at Boeing, Shanahan worked on missile defense. He oversaw the Apache helicopter, which is being used in Yemen. He also worked on the airliner side. So he spent a lot more time pushing Boeing products than he's ever spent on defense policy. And when it comes to the taxpayers versus Boeing, in his mind, I think Boeing wins out.
Can you talk more about his serving the interests of Boeing, even as acting Secretary of Defense?
Well, he was supposed to recuse himself from Boeing matters, but it's not possible to do that. Boeing gets $20 billion a year. They're the second biggest defense contractor. He's been trashing Lockheed Martin, saying Boeing could run programs better, like the F-35. Even more egregious, he's been pushing a Boeing plane, the F-15X, which the Air Force doesn't even want. And he's actually, private groups have called for an ethics investigation as relating to that. He's also, there's a whole range of issues before him that would benefit Boeing. He's a big advocate of the Space Force. You know, he's going to have to decide about U.S. role in Yemen, or at least weigh in. And Boeing sells combat aircraft, bombs, attack helicopters, maintains the planes being used by Saudi Arabia to do the bombing raids in the war. They're building a new ICBM, one of the competitors to do that, a ballistic missile. And some critics have said this is the most dangerous weapon in the U.S. arsenal because it's on hair trigger alert. The president would have minutes to decide whether to use one of these things. He's likely to weigh in if this becomes an issue on behalf of ICBMs and Boeing's interests. There's also the KC-46, which is a tanker plane. It's been so screwed up that the Air Force has decided they're not even sure they're going to accept delivery yet. How's he going to weigh in on that? Likely he's going to try to give Boeing a break. So there's a whole range of issues. It's almost hard to think of anything in the Pentagon where there's not a connection that could benefit major contractors, where Shanahan's at the middle of that decision-making. And as I said, because his career has been, you know, really shilling for defense contractors, not making defense policy, it's a huge problem.
And you've also written that his he's been involved very much in Trump's idea of developing a space development, a space force and a space development agency, which you call an authority on steroids, to shove more expensive contracts out the door. Could you expand on that?
Yes. The Space Development Agency basically wants to fast-track these weapons programs that deal with military space, the militarization of space, which means there could be technical problems, there could be cost overruns. I think the bigger issue is this administration is now talking about testing weapons in space, laser beams, particle lasers, particle beams. These are the kind of things, the sort of Buck Rogers stuff that Ronald Reagan talked about, all of which failed miserably. In fact, Shanahan oversaw the airborne laser program, which was supposed to use 747s and lasers to zap, you know, enemy missiles in outer space. That program failed. It was canceled. Cost taxpayers $5 billion. So he's basically pushing you know, let's militarize
space. Bill, we have to leave it there, but we'll continue to cover this. Bill Hartung, director of the Arms and Security Project at Center for International Policy. I'll be speaking in Northampton on Thursday and in Purchase on Sunday. Check our website. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez.